you don't have to be like, oh my God, I am so sorry, Marsha. I messed up, and I know that's not okay because people named Marsha, people named Marsha deserve the world, and I love you, and I stand by you, and it's just like, and now Marsha has to absorb all that and be like, it's Steve, yeah, yep, it's okay, Steve. In that instance, being Marsha is kind of what being trans can feel like. Hey y'all, and welcome to Clove Room. I'm not going to lie, today I wanted to film, I was in the mood to film, but I am a little brain dead after a very long weekend of working, Halloween, fall time, weather, coffee rushes. So I wanted to film a video to make sure I had one up later this week. I'm really trying to do 2 videos a week, but all of my 2 film videos were just required a little too much brain power that I don't have to give right now. So I was reaching into the memory bank to see, okay, what are some tag videos I could possibly do? Because those are a little bit easier. The kind of topic and questions are already written out for me, so all I need to do is answer them. Went through a few, and I still was like, nah, that still requires too much brain effort. And then I found one that, not that it doesn't require brain effort, but I have been wanting to film for a while, and it kind of all fell into place, and I was like, I can definitely do that one today because I have a lot to say. And that is the Trans Inclusivity tag. This tag was created by Scars to Stars Beauty earlier this year, I believe. I wanted to do it earlier this year, just didn't get around to it. A lot of my friends did it. I know Tom did it, Colin did it, and I am now going to do it. I mean, I think this is still as applicable as ever. I actually think I have more interesting things to say now because I have worked in a front-facing job as a non-binary trans person for 8 months now, and I have a lot of experiences with being misgendered, being straight up harassed at times for being trans. I am excited to give my thoughts. I am excited to do this tag, and if you do end up enjoying this video, I would love it if you would subscribe. I really enjoy talking about gender and things like that on my channel a lot, but I also do a lot of content that's focused on conscious consumerism within the beauty space as somebody who loves the beauty community and loves doing makeup. Please subscribe if you haven't already and you are interested. Either way, give this video a like. It really helps me in the YouTube algorithm. I'm not going to be tolerating hate comments on this video. If you're a troll, then you're not even gonna watch the video. But I do reserve all right to delete and block people. Everyone handles that kind of stuff differently. I just don't like to see it. I don't like to expose people to it. And I don't think those people are ever looking for a real response. I think they're just looking for attention. On that positive note, first question. What is your name? What are your pronouns? And why do you feel using pronouns are important? My name's Cam, not Cameron, Cam, and I use they, them pronouns. I think a lot of the struggle that people have with pronouns comes from an inability and an unwillingness to be awkward and to admit that you don't know what you're doing all the time and you don't always know the right thing to say. Using pronouns regularly is important because it makes it easier to be trans and it makes it easier to use they, them pronouns or neopronouns. And that in turn makes people more comfortable. And I think making people comfortable and making people feel safe is the most important work we do in the world, to be quite frank. So that's why I really think using pronouns regularly is important. I always like to explain it to people who maybe, I don't want to say don't get it, but are struggling, is it's a lot like getting somebody's name wrong. Why do we care about getting someone's name right? Why do you feel a certain type of way when a barista may misspell your name or say your name wrong? And it's because it feels impersonal. It feels like that person maybe doesn't care about you as a fully fleshed out human being, doesn't care to be polite enough to make sure they're getting your name right. And pronouns to me are the same thing. It's really just a level of respect in you saying to me, I care about addressing you properly and I care about respecting you as a person. And that also allows me to do my best work in other spaces when I have that respect and that kindness shown to me. I don't think pronouns are just, like, I think sometimes they get niched out and it's this whole thing of like, you only need to do it if somebody looks trans, or you only need to do it if somebody looks non-binary. Using pronouns regularly just makes things really clear and makes kind of the rules the same for everyone. Second question, where do you see trans inclusivity currently, and where do you see it going in the coming years? I think in today's very polarized world, unfortunately, most topics, you have one side of like the political or social aisle that is very committed to doing the most or being the most respectful. So in certain spaces, I live in Atlanta, spaces I go in and exist are pretty respectful of pronouns, are trans inclusive, do their best to have gender neutral restrooms, which I obviously appreciate as a trans non-binary person. I will say that can create some awkward moments. The other day, someone called me dude at work, a customer. That's like no biggie when it comes to me being misgendered at work. Like, I understand why people may think it's problematic to say dude. Sir or man gets me more than that does. And he was like, oh my God, I don't know your pronouns. I am so sorry. And I understand where he was coming from, but it just turned into this whole thing where he just kept kind of awkwardly apologizing and asking for my pronouns. And it became, and I think this happens a lot with pronouns when you're trans or non-binary and the other person sometimes feels like they, it's not that they don't offend you, they just don't want to get in trouble. They overcorrect, and then not only does it become a situation where you might have been misgendered, but now it becomes a situation where you have to comfort them. And in that specific instance, like, I wasn't mad at him. I knew he was trying to be kind to me, and I knew he was trying to be respectful of me, and he felt he messed up, and I suppose he did. But I think sometimes when people are so scared to mess up, like, you have to learn to be okay with sometimes getting people's pronouns wrong, which I know sounds weird coming from somebody who uses they, them pronouns, but, and I'm not saying, like, just be super cavalier about, like, constantly getting pronouns wrong. That's not cool. If you don't get it after a while and you keep misgendering me, we're going to have a problem, and I'm probably going to have a conversation with you. I mean, in the sense that you just kind of, it's like, you know, again, treat it like you're getting a name wrong. Like, if some, like, if you call somebody Mary and their name's Marsha, you don't have to be like, oh my God, I am so sorry, Marsha. I messed up, and I know that's not okay, because people named Marsha, people named Marsha deserve the world. And I love you, and I stand by you. And it's just like, and now Marsha has to absorb all that and be like, it's Steve. Yeah, yep. it's okay, Steve. In that instance, being Marsha is kind of what being trans can feel like. I just tell people, like, hey, if you mess up my pronouns, or if you mess up somebody else's pronouns, at least for me, and I think most trans non-binary people, some people may feel differently, but for me, I don't need a long apology. I don't want a big emotional moment. I just want to, if I correct you, or if somebody else corrects you, just go, my bad, and then continue. Just continue, and then don't mess up again. Like, don't mess up again. It's the best result to come from that. Because, like, I'm not gonna lie, it hurts to get misgendered. It hurts to have people still use he, him pronouns with me, or even, like, slip. But it's just doesn't need to then become me emotionally carrying you. But on the other end, back to what I was talking about originally, there's this other fork in the road where there's now a really evil is the word that comes to mind, gnarly anti-trans sentiment, where it's, how do I say this? It's one thing to not be interested in being inclusive of trans people and not think that it's a priority to try to include trans people. And I disagree with that vehemently, obviously. And I think having trans inclusive and non-binary spaces is really important, and we should use pronouns constantly, blah, blah, blah. But it's the other thing that I think the other fork in the road that we're experiencing, especially in the States and likely other places, but my experiences in the United States, specifically the South, is now people are like, how can we make the world more dangerous for trans people? Which is really, really a choice. It's just a really devious thing to do, to try to make our lives harder when our lives are already like we already have the odds stacked against us, you know? I mean, there's, and I mean in big societal ways, but I also mean, like, sometimes if you're a person who has anxiety, like I am, sometimes it can be hard to leave the house, and wearing what I feel like affirms me. I don't want to talk about it too much, but it just makes me deeply sad. Like, I mean, there's anger that comes from it, but I am now just in a place of deep sadness with how trans folks have been dehumanized, because I think, like, I grew up with people who think this way. I know I did. But then I just can't see a world where those people would want to hurt me and hurt other people like me. Like, I refuse to believe that, but their actions show that, and that's really hard to sort out, you know, mentally, of knowing that these people helped raise me and that they would be devastated if anything happened to me, but their actions and their beliefs and their social media feeds. So that's a lot to deal with. That is, it's a lot. It's a lot going on. And I'm just gonna laugh my way out of that, because I think I was about to go to like a sad crying place, but we're not gonna go to a sad crying place. We're gonna spin right out of that. So yeah. So I think it can just be exhausting, because I can be in a really overly inclusive space and kind of have to comfort people when they don't like get an A+ and being trans inclusive, but then I drive 20 minutes and I am in imminent danger. That's kind of the trans experience right now, and I don't see that changing, unfortunately. I mean I would love for it to change. I'm not as I'm not gonna act like I'm involved in activism in any way. I'm not. I mean, I try to do what I can for the people I know and the spaces I'm in, but I don't know, vote is kind of the message. And I'm realizing this is a beauty tag, so maybe we're supposed to talk about the beauty industry in this question. Which, I think, here's something that happens a lot with LGBTQ+ issues, is that when you as a community have been starved for attention and a platform for so long, you start to accept scraps. And I think sometimes we accept scraps. Society is okay with accepting scraps for us in our regard. You know, sometimes brands really get, and there's a question more specifically about brands later, but sometimes brands get like props and thank yous when they share like one thing a year on Trans Inclusivity Day, or one thing a year during Pride of like a trans woman using their products. And I think the trans community is socially and politically dealing with a lot right now, so that if you do kind of anything that is an anti-trans, it's like a big thumbs up. And I don't know, I would love to see that change. I would love to see more trans beauty brands. I would love to see more brands, you know, really make a point to use trans models and be trans inclusive in their product photography, all of that. I don't know if that's going to happen, because I've seen mainstream beauty brands say things like that or signal that they support trans causes, and it's hard to disentangle because the comments become flooded with anti-trans trolls. But then if you look at the data that have something that is not the majority of the country that is so vehemently and passionate and more passionate about this one ideology than the rest of the country that really doesn't support that. But when you have that passion, you turn out to vote in larger numbers and you speak out at town council meetings or on social media a lot more. So it's hard to disentangle, I think, for companies from a profit standpoint. And I think at the end of the day, it's important to remember that companies do things because of profits, not because of morals. Companies don't have morals. They don't. They may have ethics, but they don't have morals because they're not people. And it's hard to disentangle for them. Okay, we know from data that most of our audience or customers is supportive of trans issues. But whenever we post or have large collaborations with trans people, there is an outcry that disrupts our social media for days. And I imagine sometimes leads to other bad things happening. All right, I don't even know if I even answered that question, but I talked a lot. So number three, why do you feel it is important to be inclusive of trans folk in all spaces, not just the beauty space? I mean, because we should respect people. And I think sometimes there's a reaction of like, well, why do trans people get more Like, why are more caveats, or why are more, is more attention paid to respecting trans people when we should just respect all people? Kind of like the All Lives Matter argument. And I think if you're asking that genuinely, which I think often people are not asking that genuinely, but if you really are asking that genuinely, I think it stems from we want to respect all people, and when a certain segment of the population doesn't get respect, we want to overcorrect and make sure they get respect. So that's why it's important to make sure you are being inclusive of trans folks, because if we are just doing the bare bones generic rules of society, those are not inherently inclusive of trans folks as they are cis folks. So that's why we need to make sure that we have pronoun training in place, that we use pronouns constantly, that we have conversations about gender and sexuality in a, you know, appropriate manner and such. That's why, because if we just rely on the typical guardrails of society, that usually doesn't lead to trans people feeling included, and it doesn't usually, I mean, it can have, you know, pretty dire consequences. Number four, what trans content creators would you like to spotlight, and what have you learned from watching their content? This can also apply to non-beauty community folks. I mean, I feel like most of y'all know the trans content creators I heart. Hope Miss Tom, my buddy Tom, of course. They are an icon. I think they said this before to them, but I think they're making the most exciting content on beauty YouTube right now. I joke sometimes that it's really cool to be really good friends with my favorite beauty YouTuber. It's one of those things where they obviously already have like a pretty big audience, especially compared to like, you know, somebody much smaller like me, but they're just so good at YouTube. They're just so good at videos, and they're so talented, and they're so smart, and they're so caring that it's just a matter of time before like they get Tati numbers. Like, I truly believe like in that lineage of giant YouTubers who define beauty community generations. I'm being overdramatic, but I just love the beauty space. I believe Tom is in like up next. Like, they are a figurehead of this community and somebody I think people reference a lot. My friend Colin, of course, I'm gonna talk about Queer Bones. Colin, if I mean, and again, I know most people, or not most, but a lot of people came from Tom and Colin's recommendation of my channel. But I know y'all know how great they are, so why not talk about it more? Colin's just like, I mean, super analytical. They make it a point to say that in every video. And I appreciate them because they, I mean, I have unpopular opinions. I'm not afraid to be snarky for sure, but they sort of have a different perspective, which is not writing things off because the community doesn't like them, you know, actually reviewing things and giving things a chance. If there's a palette that you have ever been curious about, they probably have a review on it. They really are do so much in that space, and so much in reviewing brands. You know, if you ever want to buy from like certain indie brands, they have such an encyclopedic collection of content on that, and they're very analytical in how they talk about the formulas and the colors. They also just have, they have this great video, I mean, they've done this video, you should go watch that, but they have this great video that's just their personal gender journey that is probably one of my favorite videos I've seen this year. It's just, it made me feel really seen. And I think one of the cool things about knowing Tom and Colin is that I didn't really have people before I started watching them that I like truly identified with on beauty YouTube, and it's just like a lot less lonely knowing there's other NB people and NB trans people who get it, and there's just shared experiences that other folks don't have that I have with them. And it's just like, it makes me feel like I can be more myself in this space, which is really valuable. And I don't know, it's, life's a lot easier when you have a little bit of a blueprint, I found. You know, it's great to carve your own path, but when you don't see people who share certain similarities, it can feel really lonely, and knowing them makes beauty community a lot less lonely. Same with Steven too. Steven, they are incredible. They do the best swatches on Instagram. If you ever need anything or want anything or think of anything that you would like swatched, Steven probably has swatched on Instagram. Also, someone kind, Steven was like one of the first 10 people to follow me on Instagram for like no reason, because who knows what I was doing. I mean, I'm still not really doing much on Instagram, but another just super kind person. I don't know, I'm like always proud of Steven because they really have, you know, they've really struggled sometimes with overspending and overconsumption, and I think seeing them figure it out in their own way is really inspiring because I don't think it's easy sometimes. I think sometimes we simplify it and make it out to be like, oh, one day I woke up and I don't want anything anymore. And their journey is a lot more organic, and it's like honestly really inspiring to watch and watch them navigate how to love beauty and love eyeshadow and love swatching, but how to do that in a way that makes them feel comfortable. So Steven, go follow them on Instagram. Maeve Gender on Instagram. Oh my god, if you don't follow Maeve, like, you are missing out on like probably the prettiest eye looks being created right now. Maeve, like, I constantly save her posts to try to recreate later once I finally remember to, because I just, such pretty different looks, so soft but different, and like feels cutting edge but feels attainable but not, because everything's so perfected. And I just adore Maeve. I'm really always excited by what she posts on Instagram, and I think she's just getting better and better at it. Strikeadelic, my friend Ludo, he's on Instagram. He's also on YouTube. I don't think he's posted on YouTube in a while, but whenever, if he decides to come back, he is a really fun and incredible YouTube creator. Also posts some incredible looks on his Instagram. So talented again at eyeshadow. Is just really, really funny. Andromeda on Instagram. I'm sure most, like, a lot of y'all follow Andromeda on Instagram. They also are doing the prettiest the eye looks. I mean, they just posted one today that was like this green lavender moment, which is like my favorite color combo. I love like a hunter forest green type with a lavender. Oh, like, they just do really gorgeous eye looks. Not just gorgeous eye looks, but really gorgeous photography on Instagram. They are just, it's really fun every day or every couple of days when they post their looks, because they're really inspiring. They just know how to curate and really execute on an eye look, and it's really fun to see. And I've really enjoyed getting to know them better the past couple months. If I'm forgetting anyone, I'm deeply, deeply sorry. And I do want to say, I would love to follow even more trans content creators, specifically, you know, more diverse trans content creators for sure. So if you know anyone on Instagram or YouTube that I should be following, please, please, please shout them out. Let me know below. I am always trying to diversify who I follow, trying to get different perspectives, meet other people, honestly. I think that's part of the fun of being a content creator. And even before this year, I didn't even know that there were that many trans people in the beauty space, which is interesting to think about now, but it's been such a highlight of the year, is getting to actually know folks in the community. And then this is the last question. What brands do you see putting trans inclusivity into practice, and can you provide examples? Can also be non-beauty related brands. So the first one that really, really comes to mind is actually Milk Makeup. I really adore their social media presence, and I will say it's a good business move for them personally, because I have bought from Milk a couple of times when I wouldn't have been as likely to do that if I wasn't such a fan of what they do on Instagram. They have made really great content on Trans Inclusivity Day. They, you know, constantly have trans people included in their product shots or included in their events. They regularly use pronouns for even non-trans people. It's really phenomenal. And it's also because they just have a trans person on their social team. It's not just something they do for the special trans days, or it's not something they do for Pride. They have a trans person who appears to work for them, at least in a part-time, but I think full-time capacity. Blossom is their name. I really love Blossom too. Their profile, I probably should include them in trans creators. I don't know them personally, but they do a lot of really good stuff. It just makes a difference to me, because it's not always for clout. It's not always to check the social calendar off and to make sure we posted something about Trans Inclusivity Day. It's just every day you see trans people using their products on their page, which is kind of the ideal. I mean, I think it's also good to celebrate and make sure we're talking about history and trans people and makeup and all of that. I think that's just as important. Also, just not making it a big deal when you do feature trans people is like kind of ideal to me. Honestly, besides Milk, I know Colin has talked about House Labs being really, really good about it. I don't really follow House Labs. It's not like a brand I'm super interested in, to be honest. And the one product I've tried was not my favorite, but I think House Labs... Oh, Jekka Black. I don't think a lot of people talk about them. And honestly, when I tried their products a couple years ago, I really was not impressed. But I mean, if you want to explore color correcting for a beard or facial hair, I mean, they have like a whole system, and like I think they'll do education with you too if you buy their products on the feature trans people and that center trans people color correcting facial hair. So a lot of their products are, I mean, kind of designed with trans people in mind, and they're incredibly trans inclusive. So I think they're a good example. Rib Beauty has definitely stepped up and talked about trans issues. I don't think they're as great as Milk Makeup as just like naturally including trans people in their content, but they have continually posted about trans issues when that thing that I talked about earlier of like trolls really coming for them happens. And I mean, that's just what I expect. I'm not going to give them, like, I'm not going to send Selena Gomez roses for doing the bare minimum, in my opinion, of like respecting trans people. And I'm sure plenty of trans people give Rare Beauty a lot of money, but still, like, I mean, I will shout them out because not everyone is doing that. That is for sure. Not sure I can think of that many others. So thank you, Scars to Stars Beauty, for creating this tag. Thanks for Tom and Colin for doing it. Thanks all of y'all for watching. If you have any questions or want to talk about anything I said in the comments, please do. Again, we're going to be respectful and we're not going to be trolls because I will delete your comment. I really enjoy doing this. I mean, a lot of this is heavy, but it's stuff I kind of talk about and think about every day. So sharing it is something I'm really comfortable with. Subscribe if you would like to see more. Give this video a like. Helps me a lot in the wild, wild west of the YouTube algorithm. That's about it. Bye, y'all.